Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is August 13th, 2017. This is the 10th Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Favorite hymn of the church, Rock of Ages, written by Augustus M. Toplady. He was an Englishman did not like Wesley, but they agreed on most things. This is Rock of Ages, Cleft for Me, written by Augustus M. Toplady in 1776.
God the Son who has redeemed us, and God the Holy Spirit who sanctifies and keeps us in the true faith. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, our defender, storms rage around and within us and cause us to be afraid. Rescue your people from despair. Deliver your sons and daughters from fear. And preserve us in the faith of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God's Word.
Gina Pollock will be doing the reading.
Our reading from verse 2. At Horeb, the mountain of God, Elijah came to a cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts. For the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, broke down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." He said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord. The Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind, and after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake, and after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." Then the Lord said to him, "Go return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Also, you shall anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. You shall anoint Elijah, son of Shaphat of Abel-Malachi, as prophet in your place. Whoever escapes from the sword of Hazael, Jehu shall kill. And whoever escapes from the sword of Jehu, Elijah shall kill. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baals, and every mouth that has not kissed him." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim, because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scriptures say no one who believes in him will be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they called on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they called to believe in one of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Those who can in the difficulty, please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 14th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus, the Gospel read by Pastor John Pollock on Walking on the Water.
The Sea of Galilee, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to prayer. When he came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It's a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed a strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me!" Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
You may be seated. One announcement before we sing the hymn, and that is to remind you of the picnic today at immediately following church out at the reservoir. I've been asked to extend an invitation to you, even if you didn't sign up, because there will be more than enough food. So noon, the picnic out at the reservoir at the shelter house that we've been using the past number of years, which I don't know how to tell you, but it's by the visitor center.
Yeah.
It's by the visitor center. So if you go that side of the park. So everyone's invited to the picnic, so please join us. Let us now sing "Let Us Talents and Tongues Employ," page 4.
Very lilting hymn. It's a Jamaican folk hymn written by Fred Kahn, who was born in 1929, and also by Doreen Potter, who lived 1925 to 1980. These are Jamaicans, and it's a very happy folk hymn. Let us talents and tongues employ.
Jesus, I am.
We believe that God is the author of all life in heaven and on earth. We believe that Jesus Christ is the Lord of life. He died on the cross to defeat the power of death and was raised again to bring resurrection and life to all who trust in him. He lives and rules among us now and for all eternity. We believe the Spirit of God is alive among us, daily giving us new birth, filling us with grace and truth, and bringing us into one life with each other, in harmony with the whole creation. We praise God for life. You may be seated. As you give me your attention to the invictus, they have our special music for this morning.
Thank you.
good, the bad, and the wonderful. Matthew 14, 22 to 33. Just a comment, has nothing to do with the sermon. Hope this isn't your reverend, but our opening hymn, Rock of Ages, every time I hear that, I cannot help but think of John Wayne's movie, Sons of Katie Elder, as that begins with him singing Rock of Ages. I think it's the funeral of his mother, but so every time I hear that, I just see that scene from that movie. That's what music does sometimes in our life. But this morning we examine the good, the bad, and the wonderful. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. There was a businessman who was interested or became interested in the raising of sheep. And so he decided to make arrangements where he could spend the night on a Texas prairie with a shepherd and his sheep. So that night came, and as the man and the shepherd began to drift off to sleep, you could hear the long wail of coyotes piercing the air in the distance. This, of course, caused the sheepdogs to growl and peer into the darkness, looking for the enemy who may be coming near. The sheep, which had been peacefully asleep, lumbered to their feet, alarmed and bleeding pitifully. The shepherd got up and threw a couple of more logs on the fire, and as the flames shot up to the sky, in the glow the businessman looked out and he saw thousands of little lights. He realized that all those little lights were the reflection of the fire in the eyes of the sheep. In the midst of danger, he observed, the sheep were not looking out into the darkness at where their fear was planted or lurking, but instead they were keeping their eyes in the direction of their safety, keeping their eyes focused on the shepherd. From the sheep, we learn an important lesson in our pilgrimage of faith. And with this story about the sheep and our gospel lesson, we learn an even more important lesson about our continued pilgrimage on earth and our relationship with Jesus Christ. Our gospel lesson takes place after Jesus had fed the 5,000. They have now been sent home. Jesus is tired. Jesus sends the disciples off in the boat to go and cross the Sea of Galilee to the other side. He goes up into the mountains to a lonely place to pray. So we go through the night into the early morning hours, and the disciples are fighting their way across the sea. As Matthew tells us, the wind is against them, so it is making the trip more difficult. Suddenly, Jesus appears, walking on the water. The disciples are scared to death and scream that it's a ghost. Jesus tells them to quiet down, calm down, it's him, not to be afraid. Peter, taking the initiative, as he says, "Well, Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come out of the boat." And Jesus says, "Come." In this gospel lesson for today, we have what is good about our relationship with Jesus Christ. We have what is bad about our actions sometimes in relation to Jesus Christ. And we have what is wonderful about our relationship with Jesus Christ when we do the bad part that we will discover this morning. So we're looking at the good, the bad, and the wonderful. The good is Lord, if you command me to come to you on the water, Lord, if it is you command me to come to you on the water, Jesus said, come. So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water. That means to descend to the water. So Peter is looking at Jesus, trusting in Jesus. He steps out onto the Sea of Galilee and it's like stepping on a sidewalk. He just starts walking. He is being obedient. He is being faithful. And that is what we are called to do in our relationship with Jesus Christ, to be obedient and to be faithful. To not argue with Jesus, to not to tell Jesus what he really meant when his words don't seem to go along with our philosophy of life or our theories or our ideas. Not to dispute what Jesus did when Scripture tells us he performed this miracle or that miracle, but to accept it on faith, even though we may not be able to understand it scientifically or through any other kind of human endeavor. And so being faithful and obedient, this is the good. Peter gets out and is being faithful and obedient, not even thinking about that he is walking on water. And the whole time he is keeping his eyes on Jesus. He's focusing on Jesus, which is what we are to do in our daily life, is to focus on Jesus. As we continue our pilgrimage on earth, we look to Jesus. It may have been one of the apostles in the boat that wrote the letter to the Hebrews. Scholars have never agreed as to who wrote this letter to the Hebrews. But when I'm going to read to you the passage from this letter, it sounds like this apostle had in mind that night. And Peter's walking toward Jesus as he looks at him. For in the 12th chapter of the letter to the Hebrews, the apostle writes, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside our weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. How? Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. So the apostle is telling us to do what St. Peter did so far in the good part of this gospel reading for today. He focused on Jesus. He looked to Jesus. That word translated as looking to Jesus literally means to keep your eyes on the finish line, to focus on something, to lock in on something. To lock in like a missile locks in on a target and keeps going until it connects with that target and blows it up. To lock in on the finish line. All good runners, especially when it's a sprint, focus on the finish line. They don't look to their right or left to see who's running alongside and what they be gaining on. They focus on the finish line because that's where you go your fastest. When you turn to look, you lose your stride. It's the hardest thing to teach young people in football and basketball that when they break clear to keep their eye focused in football on the goal line and in a basketball game on the basket ahead, don't look back. Because that slows them down. That's going to enable somebody to catch. You just focus on that goal line or that basketball goal. And if you go up for your layup and the guy fouls, good. That's trouble for them. You cross the goal line and then someone hits you, good. You've scored the touchdown. So it's the same in life. We focus on it. We lock on Jesus. When I've preached on this passage before, you've heard me use the illustration of horse racing. When you watch a horse race, you see some horses simply have a bridle on and their number, and they seem just fine. Other horses have this thing almost seem like a mask covering their face. And there's these cup things around their eyes, like this. Those are blinders or blinkers. That horse has a problem with turning its head and looking to see who's coming up on it. and by doing so lose his stride. So the trainer puts the blinkers on, so now all he can see is the finish line. All he can see is what's straight ahead. He can't see side by side. So the apostle is telling us that as we go through life, we focus on Jesus. He's our finish line. We look to Jesus because he's the founder and perfecter of our faith. He's the trailblazer. He's the one through his death upon the cross paid the debt of sin that we owe, so that we are given that grace of eternal life simply through faith in that death upon the cross, in that resurrection on the third day, and in that ascension 40 days later. So this is the good. Peter is being obedient. He's being faithful. He's focused on Jesus. And then we come to the bad. Peter becomes distracted. Just like we become distracted in life. But when Peter saw the wind, he was afraid. That word means to cause, to run away, to be terrified, to be alarmed. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Beginning to sink literally means to plunge down into the water. It's like when you jump off a diving board and then you plunge into the water and you just go straight down. Or when you were in junior high school and you thought it was cool to, when your sister was lying in her lounge chair by the pool, to run and jump and do a cannonball so you splashed water all over her and her fancy hairdo that she had done. And you plunged down to the bottom of the pool when you did. So now Peter, who'd been walking on the water just like he was a sidewalk, is plunging toward the bottom. And he screams, "Lord, help me. Preserve me, deliver me from danger, protect me." This is the bad, because Peter takes his eyes off Jesus. He becomes distracted to his commitment to Jesus. He hears the wind, he sees the effects of the wind, and suddenly he trusts in himself and not in Jesus. So he begins to sink. So the lesson here for us is, the bad is to think we can do things ourselves when we face the winds and storms of life. To think we can handle it ourselves when faced with changes and chances, difficult situations. To think we can handle it ourselves when we face some type of calamity or disappointment or grief. But instead, continue to focus on Jesus. We can't do it ourselves. When we try to do it ourselves, and when we let things interfere with our commitment to Jesus, then we start plunging down into the depths of sin. So we keep our eyes focused on Jesus. And so Peter recognizes his mistake and he cries out to Jesus for help. Just like we are to cry out to Jesus for help. When we allow something in our daily life to distract us from our faith in Jesus, when we allow something in this life to cause us to not be that little Christ unto our neighbor, to not love our enemy and pray for those who persecute us, that's when we cry out to Jesus and refocus our vision on him instead of the things of the world. Still remember when I was in college, for 3 years of college, I went to Transylvania University in Lexington, which is about 75 miles east of Louisville, where I grew up. Once a semester, I was allowed to come home. Otherwise, I had to stay on campus. So I remember one time when it was a weekend, I was going to be able to go home. It was one of those years when Israel and Egypt and Jordan and Syria were fighting with each other or preparing to have war with the hostilities with each other. I'm standing there waiting for the bus, Greyhound bus, to take me home. And this guy comes up to me and he says, "What do you think about what's going on in the Middle East?" And I said, "Well, I'm not real concerned with it. Same thing happens every so many years." And he goes, "Oh, but it's showing us it's the end of time, the world's going to end." And this guy's wearing a big old cross. said, well, yeah. I said, well, didn't Jesus tell us that the world would eventually come to an end? He goes, well, yeah. I said, didn't Jesus tell us not to worry about it because he was in control? And he just kind of looked at it. It was like he was allowing the events to distract him so much he forgot where his hope was. Because that's what Peter did. He forgot where his hope was. And so he begins to plunge into the deep. Just like when we go through life and think we don't need Jesus for a while, or think we can do better without Jesus, and so we move away from him. And make no mistake about who moves. You know, Jesus never moves away from you. We move away from Jesus. So we move away from Jesus, thinking we can handle our own life and do our own thing, and then suddenly we're plunging to the depths, and we realize that where our hope is, and we cry out to Jesus. And that's what we see happening in our gospel lesson today. And that is the bad. Which then brings us to the wonderful. And that is Jesus saves. Jesus saves Peter just like he saves you and me. Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying to him, O you of little faith, why did you? Immediately, Jesus extends his hand, catches hold of Peter, seizes on to him, lifts him up, and says, oh, you lacking in confidence in me, why did you waver? That's what, oh, you little faith means, to lack confidence in Jesus Christ. And the word doubt means to waver. Yeah. So why, Peter? Why, when everything you've seen that I've done, why, when you were so eager to come out of that boat and join me and you had that confidence, and why suddenly did it disappear? Just because a little wind was blowing. But even so, Jesus still saves him. Jesus doesn't make him do something in order to earn his saving him. He doesn't make him require him to recite something from the scriptures or whatever. He just saves him. Just like he saves us. No matter how many times we sin, no matter how many times we stumble, no matter how many times we fail, Jesus saves us. That's a wonderful thing about our Lord Jesus Christ. He doesn't keep grudges. He doesn't make demands. He simply reaches out and grabs us and saves us from plunging to the deep. In the first letter of St. John, chapter 5, he, St. John, testifies to us about how we have salvation in Jesus and in him alone. 1 John chapter 5, verse 11 and 12, he says, and this is the testimony that God gave us. That is, this is the witness, this is the evidence that God gave us, that God gave us eternal life, and that this life is in the Son. So the witness testimony we have from God is that he endowed us with this gift of eternal life, and this gift of eternal life is found where? In his Son. St. John's not worried about being politically correct. St. John's not worried about offending somebody who is not a believer. He is simply stating what is true. His salvation is found in the Son of God, because it is God who has endowed the Son with the gift of eternal life. Whoever has the Son, verse 12, whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. It can't be any plainer. You can't put it any simpler. If you believe in the Son, you have life. If you deny the Son, you do not have life. That is why we are to focus on Jesus. That is why, like the sheep, when danger arose, they did not look out at the danger. They turned and looked at the shepherd, the person of their safety, the one who would keep them safe, we do not look at the danger, we look at Jesus Christ. And knowing that Jesus Christ is there, we can do things that we might not otherwise be able to do. There was a blind girl who was caught in a fire. She was on the 10th floor of her building. She could make it to the window, but she couldn't see anything. She could smell the smoke. She could feel the heat of the fire. She heard a fireman yelling at her, "Jump, jump." But she said, "I'm scared to jump. I can't see." The fireman said, "If you don't jump, you're going to die. Take the risk and jump." It's bad enough to jump from 10 stories high, but to jump when you can't see where you're jumping, that truly is terror. In the midst of the chaos and confusion, she then heard a comforting voice. The voice said, "Darling, jump, I've got you." She smiled and said, "Okay, Daddy, I'll jump." Jesus Christ is inviting us to jump. He knows we're nervous, but just jump. He knows we're scared, but just jump. Remember, we're talking about the Son of our Heavenly Father. We're talking about the person we know as Lord and Savior. We're talking about the person we have seen what he has done. He's giving his life upon the cross for us. Him sacrificing himself so that if we remain focused on him, then when in trouble, he can reach out and grab us before we plunge to the deep. So the good was that Peter obeyed Jesus when he said, "Come." The bad is when Peter took his eyes off Jesus and began to think he could do things himself or thus another way. And the wonderful is that Jesus saved him no matter what. The good is that Jesus calls us to come out of the boat. The bad is when we fail to listen or obey or look at something else or allow something to interfere with our commitment to Jesus. And the wonderful is that no matter how many times we do it, Jesus still saves us. That Jesus still reaches out for us. So like the sheep look to the shepherd, we look to Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. While we sing, "Come with us, O blessed Jesus," page 5, the offering will be collected.
This hymn, "Come With Us, O Blessed Jesus," the music was written by Johann Sebastian Bach, who lived 1685-1750, and the words were written by John H. Hopkins, Jr., who lived 1820-1891. "Come With Us, O Blessed Jesus," written by Johann Sebastian Bach. Gina Pollock read the scriptures today, and we have our ushers today. Gina Pollock is also ushering. We invite you to... all of you who have pets, bring your pets to the pet blessing at our Melody Cruise-In drive-in service Labor Day. Labor Day is our last drive-in service at Melody Cruise-In. Bring your pets for a pet blessing. I know you're listening to this after the picnic, but we're having a picnic today at the reservoir. We invite you to come to St. John's Lutheran Preschool Open House August 14th, Monday. You probably won't hear that, but call about the preschool, call about daycare, be involved, bring others to Christ, keep your eyes focused on Jesus and his wonderful love.
with those who carry that difficult blue stain. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Our response today be, hear our prayer. Almighty God, who laid the foundations of the earth and set bounds and limits to all things, we give you thanks for your glorious creation, including the creation of our own bodies and souls. In our sin, we earn for ourselves death, and creation itself was subjected to futility. But in your Son, you have come down to us to grant us forgiveness and new life. Help us to live in righteousness and faith in him. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O God, our King, you are the Lord of all peoples, nations, and tribes. Grant wisdom and truth to all who rule this land, that they may serve faithfully to promote all that is good and right, and to prevent and punish evil. Wherever our courts of laws are unjust and contrary to your will, reform them for your mercy's sake. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, when the disciples were frightened, your Son immediately calmed them with words of his presence. So also aid those who are sick in body or mind, those who suffer trials of faith, and those who grieve. Let their sufferings lead not to doubt, but to the confession that Christ truly is your Son, and that in him we have salvation. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Kind Father, in your grace you have given your children the promise of resurrection in your Son. Receive our thanks for all who have fallen asleep, trusting his promise. Bring us with them to the feast of joy that has no end. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever, and has taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the love of the Lord Jesus draw us to himself. May the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen us in his service. May the joy of the Lord Jesus fill our souls. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us and remain with us always. Amen. We conclude our worship with God be with you till we meet again. Page 6 in your book. Page 6.
This hymn was written in 1880 by Jeremiah Rankin, African-American pastor of the First Congregational Church and the president of Howard University. He wrote this hymn after he learned that goodbye means God be with you. Goodbye means God be with you, and that's when he wrote this hymn. It inspired Darlene Diebler, D-I-E-B-E-L-E-R, who was a missionary in 1945, to return to Indonesia when the Indonesian people sang this song, God be with you, goodbye.
Thank you.
with you till we meet again. We will meet again next Sunday at 10:30. Every Sunday at 10:30 in the sanctuary here. We'll meet together. We'll meet God. And when we serve God, we serve one another. We look into another person's face. We see the face of God. God be with you. The good, the bad, the wonderful, as we keep focused on Jesus Christ. We thank God for the flowers today. Gina and Pastor Pollock. Gina's father, Raymond Schwartz's birthday was in honor of his birthday. We have these flowers. Also, there are flowers, Ted and Helen Wallace. In memory of Ted's birthday, Ted's mother's birthday, in memory of Ted's mother. Ted and Helen Wallace, in memory of Ted's mother, sent father flowers. And Nelson Klopfenstein gave flowers in memory of the death of his son, Nicky, who died 72 years ago on August the 13th. Today is August the 13th. This is the 10th Sunday after Pentecost. We invite you to come with us, worship with us, and through Labor Day, 10 o'clock, 10:30 service is here in the sanctuary, 8 o'clock service is the Melody Cruise In, come as you are in your car, and come and wear your special shirts for football, anything you want to do, enjoy yourself. God wants you to enjoy life. And we have the last Sunday, will be Labor Day. We invite you to bring your pets, no matter what your pet is. We will bless it. Pastor will bless it. This is part of God's creation. We invite you to sign your children up for daycare. Sign your children up for preschool. Spread the gospel. Keep focused on Jesus. Jesus will save you. The good, the bad, the wonderful. The good is we keep focused on Jesus. The bad is when we lose our focus. The wonderful is when we keep following Jesus. Let our talents and tongues employ this. Let us remember the sweet by and by. God be with you. And remember that goodbye means God be with you. Every time we say goodbye, what we're saying is God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet at Jesus' feet and we can claim Him as Lord of Lords. He will always be with us. He says, do not fear. Do not focus on anything but Jesus. Jesus will be with us till the end. Goodbye and God be with you.